Stay roasted for.
Hello, art family. One of the best pieces of advice I've ever received about painting and really about, I think, life in general is a while ago I was working on a house and I have some friends who are contractors and I was constantly calling them asking what the code was or what the exact precise way to do a certain thing was. And I had all these tools I had collected and I was trying to use, and at the time I was working on a wall and I was trying to move a outlet box, and I was calling my friend a bunch to figure out what the exact way to cut a hole in this new area and put in this new box and how to work the wires into it and make it perfect exactly the way it's supposed to be and be to code and perfect and everything. And I kept calling my friend and asking him his advice on it, and finally he told me, listen, just break the damn thing and then figure out how to fix it. I find myself with painting, especially if I'm experimenting with a new medium, running into collecting all the tools I need, having all the stuff I need to make the best painting I can make, but then being dumbstruck and not really knowing what to do and how to make it exactly as I'm supposed to make it perfect, you know, the first shot, the first try. And so I love that sentiment. I love the idea of just break it and just figure out how to fix it. A lot of painting has more to do with the resolving the mistakes you've made than putting down the exact paint stroke. So what I'm doing now is I'm placing in, after doing the underpainting and yellow ochre, and then I sort of drew in the big shapes of what I'm looking at, just to get a feel for the composition and the layout of things and the perspective of the drawing. And now I'm dealing with the fact that this is a mostly gray image. It's mostly just shades of white and gray. So, much like with cooking, when you're doing something like chicken and dumplings, which is it's an extremely simple recipe with extremely simple things. So, if we're dealing with something that's very simple, it gives us a chance to really play with the field of color. Gray can be a very exciting thing when you spice it up, so to speak, and use different complementary colors set next to one another to create an optical gray that gives you a nice rhythm and a nice appealing look. So a lot of the background I'm dealing with, I did very, very close value sets. And you can see it took a lot of fumbling to get it right. I didn't just nail it every time I would put down a stroke. It's a lot of, you know, reworking the white into the burnt sienna and into the ultramarine to get about the same value. But I'm dealing with about the same value, but I'm playing with those two complementary colors of blue and then a kind of orangey brown. And that's how I dealt with most of this sketch. It's all a lot, it's mostly, I should say, variations of gray. These soft, subtle transitions in gray that you could deal with in a very bland way by just putting down gray paint. But I'm trying to get a lot of color character, a lot of harmony and vibration in that dull gray, so that it reads in the value as a gray, but there's a lot of color there to add appeal to the image. It kind of works especially well, even though this is sort of just a relatively random sketch of the stuff I use to make the dumplings in this soup recipe, but it happens to work out in a way that you get a nice unity and variety, and that there's a lot of unity in the fact that most of the image is soft transitions of gray, but then you get these really bright pops of color with the baking soda and the flour. Right now I'm just trying to treat things in their most simple form and shape, dealing with the different facets as these shapes turn in space. And then also the surface area, given that the mixing cups are made of metal and this is made of a matte cardboard. And so how then do we apply the paint and the colors to give a different sense of that? For this particular sketch, I'm more concerned with the materials that I'm sketching and the transitions of color and the value than I am the specific drawing. I never really go nuts and totally fix the mixing cups to make the drawing on them laser accurate, because I wasn't terribly interested in that for this particular sketch. I liked the way the facets changed in temperature because of the lighting scenario. So if we take a look at the lighting scenario, I'm dealing with two light sources. I have a warm light coming from above in the kitchen, and then I also have an open window nearby. So the open window is going to rake cool light across the image. The warm light coming from above is going to push warm light from the top. But what's going to happen is, in the shadows, you're going to get this rich interplay of warm and cool light. So you'll get two shadows in some areas, and some of the shadows will be really, really blue, and some of the shadows will be really, really orange. You're getting a lot of the warm light that bounces off the white counter up into the bottom-facing planes. So like right now on the flower bag, there's a lot of blue light because it's white. It's getting that blue light raked across it in the shadow areas, but then in the areas where it's pointed sort of downward because it's folded, you're picking up a whole lot of that reflected light that's bouncing off the kitchen counter. You're also getting a lot of bounce light from the really bright blue and the really bright orange of the baking soda. So you're getting that sharp reflection in the mixing cups. You're also going to get some orange shot onto the buttermilk and onto the white of the flour bag. Because that orange is so bright, it's going to shoot that orange everywhere close by. Even on the countertop. As I'm going, I'm trying to focus on picking up these subtle notes of color, particularly in the shadows, and how those shapes, the bigger shapes of these objects, turn these forms. So to me, I'm more interested in the turning of the form and the temperature that I'm experiencing when I'm looking at this than I am in the specific laser accurate contour drawing. I'm trying to do my best to stay focused on the things that do interest me, what I was just talking about in this sketch, because it's easy to get carried away. It's also easy to get discouraged if you feel like, you know, maybe the drawing's not as strong as it could be, or, you know, maybe you mess up one part of the picture. But to me, even if you do, you're still learning the lesson. So it has more to do with the lesson that you're learning and the surfaces that you're, you know, exploring and figuring out how to resolve, and the value that you're exploring and figuring out how to resolve the comparative relationships as you change the value and it changes the rest of the value. Or how, you know, is the shadow side of the flower bag darker or lighter than the shadow of this? Or, you know, when you're figuring those things out, you can learn a whole lot of lessons if you don't just scrap the sketch or get so hung up on, you know, a simple error that you made in, like, drawing or something. You can layer gouache pretty well, especially once you get the handle of it, so I'm not terribly concerned with the logos and the typography on these boxes and things. I mainly want to go for the simple shapes, again, because I'm kind of going for the simple shapes and feelings of this image to create a cohesive feeling of looking at these things, more than I am, you know, an advertisement for Arm & Hammer baking soda. Although I have seen people who will do a sketch and just like a computer turn on the typography and be able to just nail whatever font. I have horrible handwriting and I'm not terribly interested in getting better at it, so I'm not really concerned with whether or not the type looks right. I mean, if it's thick, I make it thick. If it's thin, I try to make it thin, but I'm not really interested in what it says. I'm interested in, if I close one eye and squint at it, what is the feeling of the typography on the image? You know, is it thick? Is it close together, far apart, the kerning and spacing? And I'm interested in that, but I'm not terribly interested in making a, you know, the spacing precise and accurate. Now I'm starting to work on the highlights, which is gonna kind of sell a lot of this image, given that there's so many reflective surfaces. The bowl itself sort of actually looks like a bowl now that you've added the highlights to it. Highlights and shadows with a clear object like this clear bowl are really crucial when you're trying to make them feel like what they actually are, like a clear bowl full of flour. Metal is always a really interesting surface to try to explore, especially when you're putting it up against things that are not metal, because then you can really get the sense of just how different a metal object is compared to a matte object. But it's really interesting to work on a shiny metal object because you really get to explore all the different light sources and the shadows and then the objects nearby that reflect directly into that object and how the curve of that reflection sells the shape of the metal object. There's a slight delay there in the sketch, and that's really just me trying to close one eye and squint, trying to really focus on the value relationships, and then just figure out what are the last couple notes that I want to put down when I'm closing one eye and squinting, what value relationships are not reading quite as clearly as I want them to read, or are they reading too clearly and I don't want them to read that clearly because I'd rather it be less interesting and fade back into the distance a little better. But nothing I'm doing at this point is of any importance. I feel like the lessons had already been learned at this point. I'm just kind of having fun trying to push some of those corners, push some of the temperatures, just to sell the readability of the image. So that's going to be it for this demo of some ingredients I use. I thought I'd share the recipe for this chicken and dumplings that I make. It's my favorite cold weather warm up. Plus it's super cheap and simple and it makes a whole lot. You basically start like you're making chicken and noodle soup, just without doing the egg noodles. So in a pan you're going to want to soften celery, carrots, onion, mushrooms if you want it. And then get chicken either rotisserie or cook some from others and shred it up into little bits. Put those together in a pot, heat it up to boiling with 2 boxes of chicken broth. In a glass bowl, I put 2 cups of flour, some salt, a tablespoon of baking powder, a quarter teaspoon of baking soda, and then you want to get 6 tablespoons of cold, has to be fridge cold, butter, and I go ahead and chop it up to get it ready. But you're going to want to throw it in and then use a fork or a blending tool like that one and really just mash it into the floury mix. It's crucial that it's freezing cold butter though. Then I add 1¾ cups of buttermilk. And I use a fork to gently fold it all together, but you don't want to overmix it because then it gets kind of weird and gross. But it's all the same ingredients you'd use to make regular biscuits, like honey biscuits, but you want a little extra buttermilk so that they're wet or drop biscuits that you can spoon and then drop into your boiling soup afterwards. So you spoon in enough of the mix until the whole top is covered. Make sure it's boiling, and then cover it and bring the temperature down to medium and let it sit for 15 minutes, and that's it. It doesn't look amazing, and it's not food for royalty, but it is really good when it's cold outside. I suppose this is my last video for 2018. I guess I just want to say thanks to everybody for watching and subscribing and being so kind and supportive. I look forward to future videos and getting to know more of you over time. And I'll see you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.